hello, hello. We have some math today about media lies and wasted time and energy via democracy. So the media lies, I did this math a while ago, but I added upon it and expanded it a little bit. And this math here I did a few days ago, and it really inspired me to do the full monarchism video, which I posted yesterday. And that is really just a reflection of some of the thoughts I covered in the creative destruction video as well, about just the dangers of democracy. And I was ruminating on the political parties, our political party system, and the corruption that festers within the political parties, and all of the knowledge that your average voter has to have to accurately choose so many elected officials without intimately knowing their actions and what they do behind the scenes and such. So that process of choosing elected officials, in order to do it accurately, it almost has to be a full-time job. And not only does it have to be a full-time job, it has to be a full-time job of every participant in the society. So it just has this this exponential drag on the system, on the people. And this math really had an impact on me. And I think it's really going to have an impact on you after I go over it. And that is what really kind of kicked my brain and my opinions and views on the social contract towards a full monarchism. So, with that long introduction, let's get started. So this is your news average viewers, 750,000 hours per day that they're watching. This is, this is all averages right here. The number of mainstream stations, so you have like Fox, MSNBC, ABC, NBC, all that stuff. The amount of times they're lying. So this is the percent lies. This has been going up steadily for the last 20 years, I would say. It's just been climbing, climbing through the roof. At this point, it might be 65. So anyway, you do the math, you do the crunch the numbers. This is almost 2,000 hours per viewer per year. Then you multiply by the number of viewers, and you have 1.5 billion hours per year of lies on the media, from the media. Over 25 years, this works out to be 37 billion hours of people spent in front of TVs, what's the word I'm looking for here? Marinating in CIA propaganda and brainwashing. Unbelievable. This is, I mean, this number right here is why I guess I really need to give people the benefit of the doubt, right? 37 billion hours. Now, here's the number of meme magicians. We've just entered the 21st century. We have 1,500 meme makers, the meme war veterans. It might be higher than this, but let's just start there. They create 100 memes per year each. That's one every like 3 or 4 days, which it seems about right for a meme maker, a meme magician. Average views per meme, they get 300 views, let's say. And the internet, social media has really only been influential for 7 years or so. That means for every view of every meme, the public has endured 120 hours of television brainwashing. So that's the ratio. This is the ratio we're dealing with of brainwashing. For every time you see a meme on the internet, that is equivalent to 120 hours of being brainwashed by the television, of other people being brainwashed by the television. So this is truly a David versus Goliath situation, because the ruling class, the Illuminati, the government, the Pentagon, whatever you want to call them, they have the infrastructure, they have the television, they have the broadcast networks all in their pockets, all on their team. And we got just some shit posters with Photoshop against them. and a $400 PC with an internet connection. So I mean, this is truly David versus Goliath. This is truly at the highest levels of intellectual war. So even if let's say we have 5,000 meme magicians, and they get 500 memes per view. These are all averages. So 500 is pretty high. You're still at 20 hours. You're still at 20 hours for every meme view. This might be like a little bit more reasonable. Anyway, moving on here, we have our wasted time and energy via democracy. 4 hours wasted on politics per day. This is social media, watching the news, talking to friends and family, trying to change people's mind on things. Really, I spend all of my time trying to destroy the concept of democracy. The very idea of democracy is what I spend all of my time and all of my memes trying to destroy. The idea of democracy, the idea of the state. We have 100 million democracy NPCs, people who vote. This might be a little bit lower because some of the people are voting to try and weaken the state. There's a lot of people trying to weaken the state, so let's say 60 million. This is still 350 billion hours per election cycle. You just do this multiplication. At $20 an hour, that is $7 trillion of wasted generative value. This is your opportunity cost, as the economists would say. Now that we have a dollar value of $7 trillion per election, you can calculate that, convert it to number of version 6 arcologies. 2,400 cities is what we could have built instead of arguing with each other over who to vote for. 2,400 cities, this is every election. This is a population of 348 million people, 107% of the entire population that we could house, build housing for every 4 years instead of arguing with each other over democracy, over a single position, because it's only the presidency. Everyone only talks about the presidency. It's all anyone only cares about. And since 1913, which is when this country pretty much fell apart, when the Federal Reserve was founded was when it all went downhill. And it was all destroyed, especially 1933, too. So you just do the math, since 1913, that's 2,800% of the U.S. population could be housed in arcologies if we decided to build arcologies instead of arguing over who the president is. Oh, man. Now, if you divide this by the average persons per apartment of like 2.5, you get 10. The answer is 10, right? So that would be 10 apartments for every human being in the United States. Paid in full. That's with your mortgage paid off too. Oh man. And like, what, you know, what did this do for us? What did this get us exactly? I don't know. Could someone please tell me what we've accomplished with all of this suffering and all of this arguing and all of this heartache? Liking shit on Twitter. Oh, they're giving the Twitter likes. Oh, like my stuff on Twitter. Oh, I need influence. We need more influence for democracy. Democracy and influence. It's like, it's a sad state of affairs. It really is. So this is why I went to full monarchism. And Article 14 is very interesting. I hope you've read Article 14. And to overthrow the king, it's essentially the revolution clause, is Article 14. And the beauty of it is it requires a minority to overthrow the government. It only requires 20%. And that number is, it's, you know, up for interpretation. It could be 10, it could be 15, it could be 25. In that range, I would say. It keeps the monarch honest, and that time and location where everyone meets every single month, or everyone who has very strong grievances. They could go there and they can discuss their grievances and they can expose corruption. And then ideally the monarch would try and resolve that corruption within the council system by removing judges, appointing new judges, cleaning house, essentially. And if the monarch himself is corrupt, if the monarch himself has gone rotten, then that time and that location will build a critical mass until the monarch is forced to step down by law, by the contract. The contract specifically says he must step down if 20% of the residency shows up. Has to be of the total residency. So it's not like people are going there to vote yes or vote no. You show up to the Article 14 clause specifically to vote no to the monarch. And yeah, if it was 10%, right, the monarch really needs to keep a tight ship. if 10% of the population can force a revolution at any time, every single month 10% of the population could legally force a peaceful revolution of the government forever, and then the next monarch has the exact same problem, the exact same thing every single month. And it's just it's a really great way to just have a direct conversation with people who have been wronged by the council system, who have been wronged by the court system. And obviously if the king's goons or something like that, in a worst case scenario, if the king's goons like harass anyone who shows up to this time in this location, then maybe a violent revolution would be in order. I could even throw a clause in there, actually. I was really thinking about that too. Throw a clause in Article 14 saying if any residents are harassed during this process, during this vote of no confidence or dethroning process, then that gives the people the right to violently remove the monarch from his throne and choose a new monarch. So, yeah, because, you know, this is meant to be a peaceful feedback system. It's meant to be kind of like a veto. The people kind of veto the rule of the monarch. And I think it's very interesting, and I think it's very appropriate for the veto power to be less than 50%, significantly less than 50% of the population. That obviously opens the door to subversive people, to subversive members of the population, but I can't see 25% of the population being explicitly subversive or explicitly trying to destabilize the city-state that they're living under. Anyway, you can throw your questions or comments in the video description, and of course I'll link to the full communism or full monarchism video in the video description as well. Anyway, that's it. I hope you really enjoyed this, and have a nice day. If you want to see a new and better world come to fruition, as I do, then like, share, and subscribe. You can find an incredible amount of math, knowledge, and 3D renders by clicking on the channel name. And remember, we need you to help spread this vision across the internet for all to see and become familiar with. Let us build this new world together.